I've been reading this book, Fortune's Formula by William Poundstone. This book is very interesting and worth a read. It talks about many of the figures who are responsible for cracking the modern gambling systems and sort of developing a scientific approach to betting and gambling. One of the people the book focuses on is Claude Shannon. Claude Shannon is the inventor of a mathematical theory of communication. He's another unsung inventor insofar as pop culture doesn't really recognize the full significance of what he accomplished. Comparisons to Einstein are often deemed to be unfair because, well, Einstein was a genius and he came up with various equations like E equals MC squared and general relativity that are profound. They are primarily of intellectual interest for the average person. Whereas if you look at the works of Claude Shannon, his inventions and insights and models are things that you rely on every day in the technology that you use. So he had a transformative effect on the world in a way that Einstein arguably didn't. So Claude Shannon's mathematical theory of communication was innovative because he essentially defined information and then used his account of it to develop technology on foot of that. In this video, I'm going to talk about one aspect of Claude Shannon's work that I think is very interesting to consider in terms of the constellation Dag Hypergraph. And that is this formula G max equals R. So I'm going to get into it in greater detail. But before I do that, I suppose a bit of background is helpful. So Claude Shannon, in his mathematical theory of communication, basically defined the term bit. Originally, the term bit was defined or coined by William Tukey, but Claude Shannon refined this term and gave it a precise definition. Essentially, he defined it as the amount of information that is required to distinguish between two equally likely outcomes. Okay, so that is the definition of a bit. And it is a very precise definition that draws on probability theory. So a bit is binary in the sense that it is one or zero, yes or no. That was a key part of the mathematical theory of communication. And what Claude Shannon went on to do is essentially define communication in terms of this unit. And part of what he was trying to solve was the problem of noise in communication channels. So there's really two parts to this. On the one hand, you need to be able to remove noise from a communication channel in order to ensure the integrity of the messages that are being sent. It's an essential aspect of efficient communication. It's very, very important when you have things like satellites that are dependent on the integrity of the communications being sent, satellite networks, army and military radar. These types of things you have to get the communications correct. And noise is a significant danger. Noise can be, background cosmic radiation or ambient noise or an ambient EMF. So what this was about was effectively increasing the efficacy of communications. And there were actually a few different schools of thought about how to handle this. One of the other ideas was essentially that rather than trying to refine how messages are sent and the logic and integrity of them at the model or theoretical level, they should just add more infrastructure, more cables, more satellites, and just ensure, that there's greater power and therefore greater means of sending more messages so that the integrity of any single message ceases to be as important. Because if you can send many, then it doesn't matter if one fails. And this was a school of thought that was advocated by Vannevar Bush, which was actually one of Claude Shannon's mentors. And, it obviously they decided against that because it's a much more expensive, much less reliable approach. And it's just interesting to consider the parallels between that debate then and the current debate in blockchain. If you look at some of these projects like Solana and like many other projects that hang their hat on hardware and increasing the power of their consensus and the speed of their consensus via adding hardware, it's quite similar to Vannevar Bush's view that they should add more hardware. But what Claude Shannon did was basically unbundle all of the existing thought and models and theory and rebuild it from scratch in a way that was much, much more effective. And this is basically what Wyatt has done in the blockchain context. So it's just a very interesting parallel. So that's the first part of this problem of noise and communication channels, is how you remove the noise. The next part is how you add noise. And why would you want to add noise? Well, of course, it's for the purposes of encryption. And this is essentially what Claude Shannon and Alan Turing worked on together, the Sigsaly phone. Basically, he worked with Alan Turing on this technology called Sigsaly. So a lot of people know about the Enigma, the Enigma project and the story of Bletchley Park cracking the German ciphers so that they could listen in on what the Nazis were doing in World War II. But a related project that's not as well known and that's described in this book is Sigsaly, which is essentially an encrypted phone line in order to enable the Allies to communicate securely in World War II. And there was a phone in the basement of Selfridges, that fancy shopping store in London, that Churchill would use to get on to Roosevelt in the Pentagon. And there was also lines connecting MacArthur and Montgomery in Guam and Northern Africa. So basically, this was Shannon's original focus. But Shannon eventually discovered an interesting connection between this problem and gambling. And essentially, Ed Thorpe, who's another genius and who refined some of these gambling strategies, came to Claude Shannon when Claude was in MIT and basically asked him to help him devise a winning strategy for blackjack. And it was based on some previous work, but they essentially were able to refine the strategy and discovered that many of the same ideas that applied to networks and communication applied to gambling and also later the stock market. A contrasting story that was unfolding around the same time is this, the efficient market hypothesis. You can contrast that with the work of Shannon and some of these other guys, because the efficient market hypothesis essentially believed that the market already prices in all information and events, and it is perfectly efficient as a result, so there's no possible way of gaining any advantage. What Shannon and Thorpe and Kelly and some others realized was that the market is inefficient, and you can exploit those inefficiencies through informational arbitrage. And informational arbitrage is when you know something that the market doesn't, you can take advantage of that and earn returns. Okay. So this idea is something that Wyatt has talked about repeatedly in some of the Constellation DAG talks. Prior to the hypergraph, pre-DAG era, the big tech companies basically have a massive competitive advantage because they have so much information on every user, and they can use it to engage in marketing and all sorts of nefarious purposes as well. So that's the connection here. And so they basically devised a strategy for how they could bet and basically manage their bankroll when gambling. And this was called the Kelly criterion. And the Kelly criterion, in a nutshell, is just edge divided by odds, where edge is your competitive advantage. It's the information that you have that the market doesn't. And odds are the public pricing of the bet or the stock, depending upon whether you're talking about gambling or the stock market. And so the Kelly criterion was developed by John Larry Kelly Jr., another close affiliate of these other guys in MIT. And so Kelly basically was trying to come up with optimal bankroll management strategies. And this edge over odds, there are more complicated formulations of this, but basically, heuristically, you can say that this is just the principle that you should bet your beliefs. So, for example, in a horse race, if you have, say, certain knowledge about a good tip, let's say, about one horse that's likely to win, you have, views on the other horses, about how they'll do, and you think one of them has a good chance and the rest of them are sort of more or less equally bad, equally unlikely to win, then you should weight your bets accordingly. So you should take your bankroll and give a portion, a percentage to the one that you think is most likely to win, and you give them a proportionate amount that accords with how confident you are about that horse winning. And then for the second best horse, you give a smaller proportion of your bankroll and then lesser amounts in accordance with how confident you are that each of these horses may win. And so that's essentially what the Kelly criterion is. Now, G max equals OR is a formalization of this idea, and it says that the rate of return corresponds to the flow of inside information. Okay? So let me explain this a little bit. So insider information is this idea that you get a tip where somebody says this is certain to happen. Okay? Say the mob has fixed a horse race and they tell you this is certainly going to happen. This horse is definitely going to win because we've poisoned all the other horses, right? So say you're virtually certain that that horse is going to win. You then would bet all of your bankroll on that horse, okay? And the rate of return would be totally optimal. It would be maximal, okay? Now, obviously, we don't always have virtual certainty about anything like this. This is the real world and, things can happen. So there is this notion of equivocation, which corresponds to noise in a communication channel, which is going back to this whole Claude Shannon connection with communication networks. Equivocation is uncertainty. So you modulate your bet sizing according to that uncertainty. But the point is that if you theoretically have a perfect knowledge of what's going to happen, then you can optimize your returns. And this is mathematically formulated as G max equals R. Okay, so I want to make sure that I fully explain the terms of this formula so that I do justice to it because it is really interesting and quite mystifying. So G max is equal to R. The G is the growth rate of the gambler's money. It's a way of stating the compound return rate on the bettor's investment or bet. The subscript max refers to the fact that this is the maximum possible rate of return, and that is in any given case defined by the terms of the bet or the investment. So Kelly equates this optimal return to R, which is the rate of transmission of information in Shannon's theory. So this is the inside information in a rigged bet or in a bet where you have a very good tip. And this is a really interesting connection. So a few more minor points to clarify. The currency units don't matter. The currency units are just whatever units you are using in the bet. Gmax applies regardless. It describes a rate of return, as in a percentage gain on your bet. The R is the rate of bits, the flow of information per time unit. And again, the unit of time does not matter. This equation applies nonetheless. But the time units have to be the same on both sides of the equation. So if you measure return in percent per year, you have to measure the bit rates in a per year time frame as well. So another thing to note is that the bits, when we're referring to the flow of inside information, it is the most economical expression of the outcome that is possible. So you have to be pithy, you have to be laconic. This doesn't refer to an insider tip that rambles on and contains a load of redundant information. It refers to the most economical possible expression of the winner of the race in a given case. Okay? So for instance, if you are betting on an MMA match or a UFC fight, and there are only, let's just say for the sake of simplicity, there are only two possible outcomes. All you need to convey is one bit to convey the winner, and that one bit, which is the fighter A or fighter B, is sufficient to convey the outcome. So it is as compressed as possible, and also you cannot use any less than that amount of information in order to convey the outcome. So that's what the bit rate is referring to, the amount of information and the compounding rate of growth of your return as an investor or bettor. So This is like very, very interesting. It determines how fast the gambler's wealth compounds. So we can translate this into the words of Wall Street by saying a bit is worth 10,000 basis points because one bit is 100% return, which is 10,000 basis points. So Gmax equals R actually conveys this both in that simple case and in much more complex cases where more information is required to communicate the output. So it is a very interesting formula. So how does this all apply to DAG? Well, insider information is really truth, okay? So when you have insider information, what you have is a communication of certainty, some certainty as to the outcome, right? So as we all know, Constellation DAG's Hypergraph is a truth network. Therefore, you are getting verifiable information on the Hypergraph thanks to the pro consensus. I've talked about this so much in the past, so I won't go on about it too much, but the Hypergraph, is a scalable truth network. Truth is an interesting kind of thing because truth is, time dependent, right? So certain things are true for a moment and then cease to be true. So it's important that when you communicate truth, you communicate it with sensitivity to that. And DAG, the Hypergraph, communicates information instantaneously. Okay. So this means that it is able to account for temporal decay in truth and expression and representation, which means that it can tell you when something is true. Another very important connection here to the Gmax equals R formula is that this is a formula about the bit rate. Okay. It's the flow of inside information. So we know that DAG has virtually infinite throughput. Okay. Which means that you've got infinite throughput and truth. The throughput is true. And it enables sort of complex representations of truth, so it enables more sophisticated truths than just the outcomes of a horse race. So what this means is that in my view, the Hypergraph is almost like a technological implementation of this formula. Okay? It is a technological implementation of this because it is a theoretically maximal throughput of truth, which is precisely what this formula describes. Except the only thing is that up till now, there hasn't been a technology that has been able to essentially provide something so optimal. So it means that the Hypergraph is a bloody great investment, right? Because not only are you getting the outcome of one horse race, what you're getting is ownership of the truth network through which all of that truth flows. So this is an entirely different type of bargain. You are owning the infrastructure through which the insider information, i.e., truth, flows. And you are being rewarded for that in the form of passive revenue or, all of the many things that are being built on the Hypergraph. It is truly something very, very interesting. And it is sort of fortune's formula in technological form. So this is just a little bit of a DAG bite, which I thought was very interesting and I thought was worth sharing. And I hope you enjoyed it. And please, if you have any questions, leave them in the comments. I recently finished writing a paper. It's actually still a work in progress, but there's something special about Constellation DAG. The Hypergraph has a global state attractor. And it describes my view of where the Hypergraph is evolving. Yeah. But anyway, I'll leave a link to that in the description, and I hope that you find that interesting. And please feel free to reach out to me with any comments or questions. So thanks and have a good one. Bye.